Enjoy.
Is the right room for doing presentations using BIM? Also. this is a bit improvised. I just typed some code and I'm going to talk about it. I hope it doesn't get too messy. This is some code I downloaded from the internet. It's a Ruby program that calculates prime numbers. We are not going to go over the details. This is a very old algorithm called the sieve of constants. And it brings how many there are, smaller than 10 million, I think. So I'm going to start with a demo, breaking another rule of the presentations. So I'm going to run it. I'm going to run it with Ruby 2.5, fastest Ruby ever. But I'm going to time it. Pretty fast. We got that result. That's the number of prime numbers smaller than 10 million in a bit under 3 seconds. I carefully ported this program to Crystal by creating a symbolic link to the file. I'm going to run it again using Crystal. Same result, a bit faster. There is a trick here. This command did two things. It compiled the program and then ran it. If I separate those two steps, then compile it first. This, and now I can run it. I'm going to get the same result, but yeah, pretty fast. Like, really much faster. So yeah, that's the CD demo. I could have told you that this language is fast, but I found it cool to show it. There is a second part to this demo, which is I'm going to introduce a bug. This is what I do in my day-to-day programming. So when printing my message, I'm going to make it bigger. So I'm going to uppercase the number of prime numbers. That doesn't make much sense. I'm going to run it again. I'm going to run it with Ruby. I should have here, not here. Yeah. So the prime numbers are being calculated again. And now I'm going to print the message, and Ruby says, hey, you can probably not do that, which makes sense. If I do the same with the Crystal version that got updated with the bug automatically, it doesn't even go back, it doesn't start. It's not possible to run this program. The compiler is saying, hey, you cannot do that, but it didn't need to run the actual program. That's the second part of the demo. That's the second very interesting thing I want to show you about Crystal. So, so that's the plan for today, more BIM. This is what we are going to talk about, and this is the actual code I'm going to be talking about. So let's start with some facts. What is Crystal? Or better first, what is not Crystal? What Crystal is not? It's not a Ruby implementation. It's not a JRuby or Ruby is an alternative implementation. If the language is similar enough so that if you are careful, like I was, you can write a program that works in both, but it's a different language. In general, you cannot just run a Ruby program using Crystal, like I just did for my demo. So what is Crystal? Crystal is a language. And its design goals, I copied them from the website, is to have a similar syntax to Ruby. We already talked about that. It's a statically typed checked. So we compile, as we saw, and the types are checked when we compile. And the idea is of it being very efficient, as efficient as possible. This is all a bit abstract, so I'm going to translate it for Rubyists, because that's what most people here are. So what does this mean for Ruby? Well, it's a language that is very similar to Ruby, so if there is something I don't talk about, you can assume that that is like a Ruby. But there are some differences, and I'm going to talk about them. It is compiled, and it's very fast, as we just saw. It has types. We saw a hint of it. We are going to see more about that. It has a very big standard library, very complete. And it's like modern. There are stuff there that is in the Ruby standard library. You don't have the metaparameter stuff you haven't written. So that's why I said you cannot just run race, for example, because all the metaparameter stuff is not there. But we have a different kind of metaparameter. You can achieve very similar things from a very different, in a different, very different way. So let's go to start with talking about the types. Every expression in Crystal has a type. And that's informed by the compiler, and the compiler says that every method you call on the expression is a method that that type responds to. So if I have this this example that I have here, I find a class. This looks a lot like Ruby, right? I have a class that has a method, and I have another class that doesn't have that method. So if I run the code, I instantiate it and I create, I call the method. If I run the code, I'm doing now, that's what we expect. Printed the result of calling the method. If I do a small modification, right, recreating the object, I'm calling the method, a method that doesn't exist, this is not going to compile. Remember, all the time, this code didn't run, it didn't get started. You saw that it was very fast. Compiler read the files, and said, I cannot do anything. You are calling a method in an object that is of a type, doesn't have a method. In compile time, as I said. I'm a bit sorry about the chaotic thing because I didn't prepare much. I'm just talking about what I'm reading in my screen, which I wrote this morning. An interesting thing is that we have inference. That means that we don't need to be explicit about the types. I didn't need to annotate in any way that code to say that object has the type of that type. The compiler said, well, you're instantiating the object, that variable has the type, and I check that when you call the method. So most of the time, you don't need to write those types. Things have types, but they are most of the time inferred by the compiler. I think there is an example about this. No, this is an example about it being explicit. This is something that is not Ruby anymore. I define a method that has a parameter, and I say that parameter is a string. Okay? And it has to be, and I cannot call that method passing something that is not a string. So if I run this code, what was written happened, but if I do this modification similar to before, I'm going to call that method passing an integer. That doesn't compile. It's telling me, hey, that method exists. It's not the same number as before. That method exists, but it has to pass a string and you pass an integer. Once again, compile time. This is an example about it being types being inferred. In this case, I have this method that returns a string, but I don't say I return a string. The compiler says, well, compile the code and say, oh, it is a string. So that method returns a string. When I do this code in the last line, which is upcase the result of that method, the compiler will say, this method returns a string, you can totally upcase it. So is that what is expected? But if I do this modification that I have prepared here, where the method now returns an integer without saying it anywhere, it just does, then this doesn't compile anymore. It's just saying, hey, you're calling upcase on something that I know it's an integer. Once again, compile time, it's that it's not an integer. It's like, I know it's not going to be an integer because a string because that method returns an integer. So I cannot compile this. I cannot create the binary for you to execute. And a last example is this exact same example that we have at the beginning, but in here, I'm not saying that the parameter is a string. But the compiler is saying, well, maybe it's not a string, but it's definitely something that needs to respond to updates. That's the inference it's doing from the code, saying, well, whatever you pass here, it must respond to updates. It's a way to say it must be a string, probably. So if I run this, as before, it does the same thing. I'm not going to run it because it does exactly the same error as before. The message is probably different. I'm not sure about that. Yeah, it's saying, well, this thing is a is an integer, and you are calling update, so this is mobile. As I said, we have types, and this person has a type, every method has types that is spent as arguments, and a type that is returned. But most of the time, we don't need to specify them, so that makes this type system not very annoying. Most of the time, you can program using the same model you would do in Ruby. And another feature that makes it so is a feature called union types. A union type is the union of two or more types. It's an alternative. You can say, well, I have this thing that it's either a string or an integer, for example. And that's a type, and it's sometimes what it's inferred from the code. So if, for example, I write this code, yeah, I'm saying, yeah, I'm defining this method, and I'm saying it receives a parameter that is either a string or an integer, okay? Then I can call it with both, but yeah, I was very careful to call a method on it that exists in both, because a union type responds to the intersection of both types that have been united. That's what's expected. I don't know, there are many more things you can do with both a string or an integer than maybe the next one. So that about union types. That's another thing that makes it easier to work. Sometimes this would be inferred because of the different code you have to a method. The compiler would say, well, it's called sometimes with a string, sometimes with an integer, so that's a union type of a string and integer. I will make sure that only methods that can be called on that union are called. Another example of something we can do similar to Ruby is we have the famous type typing, which is usually understood as an advantage or an application of dynamic typing, but it's not necessarily so. In this case, the compiler, I'm not specifying any type anywhere, but the compiler is inferring because of the code that the parameter to that method needs to be something in which you can call quark. So as long as that those methods, those classes both have the quark method, that will work. Yeah, one is a duck, one is almost like a duck. If I happen to okay, that's what I want to do. One of the objects now doesn't work anymore. It happens to be the duck itself, that's a bit weird. Yeah, this no longer compiles. Once again, compiles. It will never be run because it doesn't compile. It's saying, hey, you're making quarking something that doesn't work. I don't care if it's called duck or whatever it's called. Probably a bit fast, I would say. I don't know if it's being helpful. So, one interesting thing that happens with union types, as I said before, when I have an integer string, there are not many things that I can do with that because they are two types that don't have a lot in common. But there is something that I can do because the compiler is pretty clever. I can do this. I can do something that we don't usually do in Ruby, and if we can, but we don't usually do, which is checking the type of there are some comments there in Spanish, and I say that. I hope they help. In this case, it's a similar method as before. We get a parameter that's either a string or an integer, but we check what's it. And then in this case, we can do the code because the compiler is clever, and inside the if, it says, oh, I checked that this is a string. So here, it's no longer a union of a string or an integer. Here, it is a string. And here, it is an integer. So this really works. I didn't bring anything, I only called the code. this code works, and that's what is expected, but it's very ugly. That's why we never write in Ruby. But we have another feature that helps with this. This is equivalent code. We can do method overloading, and we can define two versions of the method with different signatures. We say, hey, if you pass a string, do uppercase. And if you pass, it's the same method, but I define it again with a different signature. If you pass anything else, just convert it to string. It runs. When I pass the string, it makes it uppercase. When I pass an integer, it just converts it into a string. So yeah, another feature, another difference between Ruby and Crystal that is really useful. What else? What's next? I'm reading my own text to see what's next. That's weird. Yeah, generics. This is another example of something that we don't have in Ruby. It doesn't make sense when you don't have tags, but it doesn't really. Generics means, it sounds like very sophisticated, but what it means is that tags can have parameters, and those parameters are other tags. That sounds super weird, but it's simply this idea. In Ruby, an array is an array. It's an instance of the class array. But in Crystal, there is not a single array class. There is an array of string, which is different from an array of integer, or of an array of arrays of string, or whatever. The array type has a parameter, which is another type. And I can call this code only because I'm passing the right thing. I'm passing an array of strings. If I were passing an array of integers, this wouldn't compile. By the way, this I wrote it because it's useful to document that, but that would be inferred because it's each, the compiler will, I'm calling each, the compiler will know that it's an array or an enumerable. Because I'm calling uppercase, the compiler knows that whatever is inside is something that must respond to uppercase, which is only a string of the array. How does that work? That doesn't mean, I say, there are a lot of array classes. Are they all defined? No, that's what the generics thing means. And that's an example in which I create my own type that is a generic. It's just a silly container that does what an array does, more or less. So I'm saying, hey, I defined this class, it's called container, and it has a parameter. It's a container of something. And that something, I'm giving it a name, I'm calling it T. And then I can use that T inside the code. And that T refers to the type that it's there in each case. So for example, then in the code, I'm saying I'm creating a container of strings and I'm adding a string, and that works because I define the add method to expect a parameter of the type T. And the same with integers. That creates something like that, that shows that it works. And all those things are checked in compile time. Now we are getting into something a bit more complicated. I hope I'm able to explain it in a relatively easy way. I said before that we don't have the metaprogramming facilities we have in Ruby, but we have different ones. They are macros. Macros is a type of code. They are like methods, but the difference is that they only run on compile time. And they generate code that is what gets compiled. So the end result is static code, but it can be relatively dynamic at compile time. That's super weird, right? I'm going to show some examples. So in this case, I'm defining a module, and I'm creating a macro, which looks a lot like a method, which has parameters. What I'm doing inside the macro is generating the code that I want to be generated whenever I call the macro. And I use this embedding character to do that. So that will generate a dev self dot URL that will return the string with a conf. And what is this there? So I'm creating like some kind of DSL, very silly by the way, but I'm creating some kind of DSL. That happens in compile time, so it's not really dynamic, but it looks like it. So yeah. We don't have method misery. That's a bit incredible, right? Difficult to believe, but we have it. It is a macro. call. So it never happens on runtime. It happens on the compiler. When the compiler gets a call to a method that doesn't exist, it checks, oh, maybe there is a macro called method missing that would generate that method. So in this case, what I'm doing is, that's a very long thing, but basically what I'm doing is that method missing dynamically generates the methods, whatever method calls we get, and it returns the name in all caps. There it is. Method missing in a static language. That's weird. Another interesting thing is that this code runs. So this is a bit more complicated. What I'm saying is that I can raise an exception in a macro. And what this means is not that I define a method that raises that exception. But, well, this method missing implementation checks what is the method. It's an example to see that you could do things like looking in a file, or looking even have that weird idea to look in a database schema, but always on compiler. You can do that. But if I happen to call this this method, that's when we will get the exception. And the interesting thing is that that exception happens in compiler. Okay? So if, for example, I have created a method missing that looks in a file for definitions of something, and that file for some reason doesn't exist, that will happen always in compiler. My final code will be, as everything else, type check, statically compile, etc. In fact, the end result of my metaprogramming there with method missing is exactly that. And when I say exactly that, it's not that it does the same, it's that it generates this code. The binary will be the same. It generates the code in compile time and compiles it. So this code is the same as the one I wrote with method missing. Okay. I don't know how I'm doing on time. I think, well, because I'm almost done.
Ah, that's good. That's good.
I obviously didn't practice this. So, I even wrote it here. Macros are like methods that run at compile time and generate the code that will be run. Okay, now we are going to talk about the second last topic, I think, concurrency. This is a heated topic nowadays because you should expect a new language to be concurrent and parallel, and Crystal isn't parallel, it's only concurrent. That's the reason why there is not yet a 1.0 version, because they were explicit in the roadmap that they wanted to have parallelism before releasing the 1.0 version, and there is a branch working on it, and it's not there yet. We have concurrency, so things we can do things as long as they are input output and things like that. We can have concurrent code. And the way it works, in the API, it's very similar to the concurrency model of Go, if you know it. You have channels, you have fibers, and the channels are how fibers communicate. So I have a couple of examples about this. You have Spawn, which is a macro, but that's a detail that is not very important. Whenever you do a call, you can put it before, and that means that it will start a new fiber running that call. You can either add it on a method call, or you can call it with a block, and it does the same. It runs that block or that method in a separate fiber. So for example, I wrote this example. Here, I create a channel of strings. A channel is a way to send data from one fiber to the other, but it's a binary type, so I can say what kind of data I'm expected to send, and if I try to send something else, it doesn't compile. And then I have two different fibers sending each other ping and pong. Not the most useful program ever, but that's how you write this kind of code. And this was a walk around the main things that I consider interesting from the point of view of a Ruby crystal, because they are different than Ruby and they are useful. I wanted to mention a couple of other things. There is an ecosystem. It's not as big as the Ruby one. It's not as complete. But there are interesting libraries around that you can use for doing many things. I wrote here a couple of examples. Kemal is a library very similar to Sinatra in Ruby to do web servers. It's very fast. It's impressively fast. Daki is a bigger framework. It's also a web framework. I haven't looked at it in a lot of detail. It's kind of bigger. Sorry, I was getting dry. I was saying it's bigger than Kemal. It includes database and abstraction library and all these kind of things. It's interesting, and it's probably the thing that is moving faster now in this ecosystem. I mentioned some other things. There are libraries to access the typical databases, the MySQL driver, Postgres driver, Redis driver. There is an implementation of Sidekick that, if I'm not wrong, you can use together with the Ruby one so that you can have Ruby code putting jobs there and a crystal worker running them, which is a really neat use case. There is also, because of the performance, there is a lot going on in game development. There are libraries to use SDL and things like that. I wrote this list, things I could remember. I think there are interesting things going on. A last thing that I wanted to mention is that a part of the ecosystem that is very interesting to have a look at is Crystal itself. Crystal is written in Crystal, so it's really easy to understand. And it's very interesting to see the implementation of things like a string or an array or all that is written in Crystal, which is, as we saw, it's pretty similar to Ruby. That I found that very interesting as a learning exercise to read a compiler or this kind of code. There are a lot of documentation to see. I hope that was useful as an introduction. Thank you.